Well, good evening, everyone, and early Merry Christmas to you. We're so happy to have you here joining us tonight, and as we, of course, do our very first ever Christmas Eve service. And if you didn't get one as you came in, Jimmy does have candles there. And there are new electronic candles because of the brand new cushion covers and carpeting. So we're just trying to be good stewards of the blessings that we've received this year in the sanctuary updates. And we'll instruct you later on in the service when to go ahead and turn those on to participate with us. So we just want to welcome you today, and God bless you. Thank you so much for being here this evening.
Thank you. seated. And thank you so much for being here on this Christmas Eve service that we have. We're thankful to share it with you. And I'm going to ask Stephanie if she would come now and do our first reading, taken from the book of Isaiah.
Therefore, the Lord himself will give you a sign. Behold, the virgin shall conceive and bear a son, and shall call his name Emmanuel. For unto us a child is born, unto us a son is given, and the government will be upon his shoulder. And his name will be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. Of the increase of his government and peace, there will be no end. Upon the throne of David and over his kingdom, to order it and establish it with judgment and justice, from that time forward, even forever. There shall come forth a rod from the stem of Jesse, and a branch shall grow out of his roots. The Spirit of the Lord shall rest upon him, the Spirit of wisdom and understanding, the Spirit of counsel and might, the Spirit of knowledge and of the fear of the Lord. Arise, shine, for your light has come, and the glory of the Lord is risen upon you. For behold, the darkness shall cover the earth, and deep darkness the people, but the Lord will arise over you, and his glory will be seen upon you. The Gentiles shall come to your light, and kings to the brightness of your rising.
Thank you, Steph. At this time, Cassie and Shane are going to come and share with us a song. We are thankful that they are willing to come and do that tonight. So guys, come on, start getting ready. Again, we just want to welcome all of you and thank you for being here on this Christmas Eve night. And we're just excited about Cassie and Shane singing for us here tonight. So this is Cassie and Shane Fabiani. I think you're going to really enjoy this.
Do you guys sing together a lot?
No.
Wow. That was so good. And I had heard Shane sing so many times before. But Cassie, you did a great job with it, man. I'm telling you. I mean, you guys should get together. It's wonderful. God was good. We're glad to have you guys with us. And Pastor Brian's going to come and share some readings with us from Luke chapter 2.
Luke 2, 1 through 20. In those days, Caesar Augustus issued a decree that a census should be taken of the entire Roman world. This was the first census that took place while Quirinius was governor of Syria. And everyone went to his own town to register. So Joseph also went up from the town of Nazareth in Galilee to Judea, to Bethlehem, the town of David, because he belonged to the house and line of David. He went there to register with Mary, who was pledged to be married to him and was expecting a child. While they were there, the time came for the baby to be born, and she gave birth to her firstborn son. She wrapped him in cloths and placed him in a manger, because there was no room for them in the inn. And there were shepherds living out in the fields nearby, keeping watch over their flocks at night. An angel of the Lord appeared to them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were terrified. But the angel said to them, "Do not be afraid. I bring you good news of great joy that will be for all people. Today, in the town of David, a Savior has been born to you. He is Christ the Lord. This will be a sign to you. You will find a baby wrapped in cloths and lying in a manger." Suddenly, a great company of the heavenly host appeared with the angel, praising God and saying, "Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace to men on whom his favor rests." When the angels had left them and gone into heaven, the shepherds said to one another, "Let's go to Bethlehem and see this thing that has happened, which the Lord has told us about." So they hurried off and found Mary and Joseph and the baby who was lying in the manger. When they had seen him, they spread the word concerning what had been told them about this child, and all who heard it were amazed at what the shepherds said to them. But Mary treasured up all these things and pondered them in her heart. The shepherds returned, glorifying and praising God for all the things they had heard and seen, which were just as they had been told.
I don't know about you, but those passages of Scripture from Luke chapter 2, for me, just really sum up so much of what we accept as the Christmas story. You know, in our house, it's tradition for us, first thing on Christmas morning, we read Luke chapter 2. And to hear that, those words, it really puts a perspective on this celebration we have. This is really what it's all about. And so tonight, as we've been talking about and looking through the different gifts that God has given us to survive Christmas, we look to this on this very somber night, on this very holy night. We look to that final gift of the four gifts that that God has said to give us. So let's go and let's look in this final gift here and see exactly what it is that God has in store for us on this night. And of course, final gift is the gift of love. The gift of love that is what Christmas really is. It shows the love of God to us. And so this gift of love is what we're going to look at here tonight. It's that gift of love that we celebrate as we celebrate Christmas. It's that gift of love that came from God for us. In Galatians 5, where it says the fruits of the Spirit are a number of those gifts that God gives us, this fruit basket of his gifts to us is love. It starts out with love. That's the gift that God has. That's the primary, the first, the foremost, the gift of God's love to us, of course, through Jesus Christ. Of course, we thank God for those other gifts as well. Peace and patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. Against these things, there is no law against them, but we're thankful for these gifts that God gives us, and tonight we focus on that incredible gift of love. As Stephanie read those passages from the book of Isaiah, we see the love of God being interjected into mankind. Jesus came at a time when the world was full of corruption. The government was full of corruption. There was oppression all over. And yet God interjects himself through Jesus Christ in that time. I love in verse 2 of chapter 9 where it says, the people walking in darkness have seen a great light. And it doesn't take much light to dispel darkness. And it doesn't take much love to dispel hate. And here, on those living in the land of deep darkness, a light has dawned, it says. And I'm thankful for the light that has dawned in our lives of Jesus Christ. For unto us, it says, a child is born. Unto us, a son is given. We love those passages. His name will be called Mighty God, a Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. These are verses that really come and bring us to the core of who we are. We see that at this time there would be a turning that would take place. And quite often it seems like, you know, it's darkest right before the dawn. It seems like right before everything's going to fall apart, the answer comes through. You know? And I heard a message about 2020, and they said, 2020 is God's been pruning through 2020. Pruning the church through 2020. Pruning our lives through 2020. And pruning is a good thing. Pruning produces greater fruit. You know? And so even though we live in a time where it seems like there's incredible darkness, know that the dawn is coming, that light is coming. There would be a change. Darkness would now be light. God would interject. A child was being prepared. A gift was being prepared for the world. A child would come and make the change. The present that God gave us was a baby. A great light, the light of the world, this Jesus that we celebrate. The rabbit was a young virgin girl of Galilee who was blessed and found favor with God. The ribbon was the angelic choir lifting praises on an anything but silent night. The bow was the astronomical pronouncement of the star that shined in the east that led the Magi on their journey. See, there was a change in perspective that God orchestrated in the world at that time. There was the before and the after. And we're familiar with this as people, the before and the after in our lives. We look at things as before and after. You know, think about this. There was a time in your life that you couldn't wait until you could drive. How many of you remember that? Yeah. You know, you couldn't wait until you could drive. And then there was like freedom that came with getting that license. Even if you had to ask permission to use your car. How many of you looked forward to that time? You knew that things were going to change when you graduated from high school or you graduated from college. And there was that time of change in your life. And it was a before and after. You know, if you think about it, your life is so full leading up to that. And then afterwards, it sort of makes what happened before really look small. And then maybe you were looking forward to the day when you got married. And then there's a before and after in your life as a married person. And then, of course, nothing changes us like children does. You know, there's a before and after when you have a child. You know, you think your life is complex, you think life is beautiful. You know, and it is. But then when that child comes, everything changes. You know? I love that song that Faith Hill sings, A Baby Changes Everything. If you're a parent, you totally understand that. You know, a baby does change everything. And at the same time, the baby that came in that manger changed everything as well. I thought it was interesting. As I looked into the background of the song, A Baby Changes Everything was written by Craig and Kimberly Wiseman. Isn't that interesting? It was also written, there was a third guy who joined them to write the song. His name was James Nichols. Nicholas. that's really a coincidence, you know? The wise men understand, listen, a baby changed. For the wise men, a baby changed everything for them. They left where they traveled afar to come. That beautiful song that Shane and Cassie sang tonight, you know, even that baby coming really changed even the angels, you know? All of a sudden there was their God being born into human flesh, you know? Amazing, absolutely amazing. It changes everything. It changes everything. The words of that song says, a baby changes everything. A baby changes everything. Hallelujah. My whole life is turned around. I was lost, but now I'm found. A baby changes everything. Yeah, a baby changes everything. See, there is a message of good news that that baby brings. There's a message that came into the world in a very dark time, in a time when oppression ruled. There was a message of hope and deliverance that came through that baby. That message is good news. See, the angel's message there in Luke chapter 2 was, behold, I bring you tidings of great joy that will be for all the people. For unto you, today in the town of, I'm quoting King James here, today in the town of David, a Savior has been born to you. He is Christ the Lord. This will be a sign to you. You will find the baby wrapped in cloths and lying in a manger. I mean, Pastor Brian read those verses. But there is something different now. There's a change that takes place now. Suddenly, a great company of the heavenly host appeared with that one angel, and they began to praise God. It doesn't say they sang. I happen to think they did. But they declared, glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace to men on whom God's favor rests. Wow, what a beautiful message and change that takes place. This is love defined. This great gift that God has given us, this gift of love, this is love defined when Jesus came into this world. You know, Jesus came along later on and he said, greater love has no one than this, that they would lay down their life for their friends. And we see that's what Jesus came into the world for. He came to lay his life down. John writes in his first epistle, chapter 4, he says this, dear friends, this is how God showed his love among us, John says. Verse 7, dear friends, let us love one another, for love comes from God. Everyone who loves has been born of God and knows God. Whoever does not love does not know God, because God is love. And you might say, well, people can love if they don't know Jesus. That's true, because God stamped his image on every human. We were created in his image, the ability to love, even sacrificially. Even people who don't know Jesus can love sacrificially. Why? Because that's the stamp of God upon them. But it's wonderful to know the love of God through Jesus Christ so we can be even more sacrificial with our lives. Verse 9 goes on and it says, this is how God showed his love among us. He sent his one and only Son into the world that we might live through him. This is love. Not that we love God, but that he loved us and sent his Son as an atoning sacrifice for our sins. Dear friends, since God so loved us, we also ought to love one another. No one has ever seen God. But if we love one another, God lives in us, and his love is made complete in us. This is how God showed his love, by sending his Son, Jesus Christ, by literally God becoming a person, a human, taking on himself human flesh. The incarnation, Jesus coming, this shows the love of God. Why? Just because he was born? No, because he was born with a purpose. And he came to fulfill that plan of God, which led him to Calvary. That's what's so great about this provision that God made for us. God's provision is shown through Jesus Christ coming. I mean, it's why we give gifts. I mean, think about this. On the flip side of this, you know, God gave his Son, Jesus Christ. And the world today gives gifts because of that. You know, think about that. I mean, he's made such a change. Now listen, there's going to come a day in this world, down the road, during the tribulation, when there's two witnesses that are here on this earth. And things are going to, you think things are bad this year? Just hold on, listen. It's nothing. It's nothing. You read what the Bible says about the way things are going to be during the tribulation. It's nothing whatsoever. God has provided his love for us. During the tribulation, those two witnesses that share the word of God, literally, they get in the face of the beast, of the Antichrist. And finally, the Antichrist is able to kill them. And when he kills them, the world, it says, will give gifts to each other. Isn't that bizarre? You know? So you think it's wicked now, just so you guys know. No, listen, the light of the gospel is still here. God's love is still here. You know? Things are not, they're not that bad. You know, I'm not saying we should put our heads in the ground. But God's love is here for us. His provision has been given to us. Jesus Christ is here. He blesses us. He loves us in such a way. In John chapter 3, these verses that we know and love, you can't Well, it used to be you go to a sporting event and not see it somewhere plastered in the stands. Although it's hard to put the mannequins up there with signs now, I guess, in the sporting events. But there was always John 3:16 somewhere, you know? And that verse just talks, it just oozes the love of God through Jesus. Verse 14 says, just as Moses lifted up the snake in the wilderness, so the Son of Man must be lifted up, that everyone who believes may have eternal life in him. For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish, but have eternal life. For God did not send his Son into the world to condemn the world, but to save the world through him. Amen. So this gift that we receive tonight, and this gift that we share with others through this season, signifies that incredible gift that God gives, that continues to give in our lives. And I'm thankful to have been a recipient of it. This love cannot be silenced. It can't be overlooked. It can't be substituted. And it can't be destroyed. I mean, think about it. I just watched a special on the Charlie Brown Christmas special. Yeah. You know, when that was put out back in 1965, Charles Schulz looked at the world, and the world thought it was in a bad place in 65. You know, in the United States, we thought we were in a tough spot in 1965. We didn't know the way things were going to become. You know, but Charles Schulz, he puts out this cartoon for CBS, and they rejected it because they said it was too spiritual. It was too Christian. And do you know, that has not failed to show a single year since 1965. In fact, one of the networks thought they were going to buy it this year and not let anybody else see it. There was outcry. And it was released. Why? Because folks are hungry for this love, this good news that God has given us. You know, Schulz was worried in that time. Think about this. It was 1965. Now, let me make an admission. I was around in 1965. I was a little kid. I was only 3 years old. I was just a little kid. Schulz was worried about, how many of you have watched that special? I guess if you've been in a coma for the past 60 years, you haven't seen it. Everybody's seen that, right? Schulz was worried about the commercialism of Christmas in his day. I mean, think about that. He was worried. It's scattered throughout the entire movie, the entire cartoon. It's talking about the commercialism of Christmas and trying to bring people back to the message. Folks, listen, that message is still going strong today. Listen, it still is Merry Christmas. Even at Target, they'll still say Merry Christmas. You know what I'm saying? I mean, listen, people try to stamp out the love that God has shown through Jesus Christ. It cannot be stamped out. It's still going strong. It's still happening. That was 5.5 decades ago. The message is still as strong today. Regardless of how many Scrooges or Grinches there may be around us, the message of the love of God sending his sacrificial gift of Jesus Christ to mankind still rings across the land tonight. Even in 2020, the message is in silence. The message is still there. In fact, I think it's stronger than ever in the United States. Really, I really believe that. I mean, that message is going out strong tonight, that Jesus Christ has come as God's gift into this world. I want to share a story before we go into our gift of the light here in just a moment. And if that Billy and Heather, you guys can climb back up and get into your places. I want to share this story. I heard this story a number of years ago, and it really sort of rang true into my heart this year. You know, because 2020 has been such a challenge. You know, and we wonder, you know, what does the future hold? Listen, guys, Jesus is still in control. We know that. This story was told by a woman by the name of Kim Mill. And she says this, each December, I vow to make Christmas a calm and peaceful experience. I have cut back on non-essential obligations, expensive card writing, endless baking, decorating, and even overspending. Yet still, I found myself exhausted, unable to appreciate the precious family moments and, of course, the true meaning of Christmas. My son, Nicholas, was in kindergarten that year. It was an exciting season for a six-year-old. For weeks, he had been memorizing songs for his school's winter pageant. I didn't have the heart to tell him I'd be working the night of the production. Unwilling to miss his shining moment, I spoke with his teacher. She assured me there'd be a dress rehearsal the morning of the presentation. All parents unable to attend the evening were welcome to come then. Fortunately, Nicholas seemed happy to that compromise. So the morning of the dress rehearsal, I found it 10 minutes early, found a spot at the cafeteria floor and sat down. Around the room, I saw several other parents quietly scampering to their seats. As I waited, the students were led into the room. Each class, accompanied by their teacher, sat cross-legged on the floor. Then each group, one by one, rose to perform their song. Because the public school system had long stopped referring to the holiday as Christmas, I didn't expect anything other than fun commercial entertainment, songs of reindeers, Santa Claus, snowflakes, and good cheer. So when my son's class rose to sing Christmas Love, I was slightly taken aback by its bold title. Nicholas was aglow, as were all of his classmates, adorned in fuzzy mittens, red sweaters, and bright snow caps on their heads. Those in the front row, center stage, held up large letters one by one to spell out the title of the song. As the class would sing, C is for Christmas. A child would hold up the letter C, then H is for happy, and on, until each child holding up his portion had presented the complete message, Christmas Love. The performance was going smoothly until suddenly we noticed her, a small, quiet girl in the front row, holding the letter M upside down, totally unaware that her letter M now appeared as a W. The audience of first through sixth graders snickered at this little one's mistake. She had no idea they were laughing at her, so she stood tall, proudly holding her W. Although many teachers tried to shush the children, the laughter continued until the last letter was raised and we all saw it together. A hush came over the audience and eyes began to widen. In that instant, we understood the reason we were there, why we celebrated the holiday in the first place, why even in the chaos, there was a purpose for our festivities. For when the last letter was held high, the message read loud and clear. Christ was love. And I believe he still is. Kim Hill says, I'm amazed in his presence and humbled by his love. See, God's love is what Christmas is really all about. He loved the world so much that he gave. He gave Jesus to us. That we receive tonight with gladness. He is love. God is love. May we love like he loved us. Amen? Amen. Pray with me. Jesus, we thank you so much for the love that you have shown to us by coming into this world, by leaving the ivory palaces of heaven, where you were worshipped, and in coming, and not coming into a palace here, but coming to a very lowly place, a place that was forgotten by so many. And yet you came and showed God's incredible love to us, and we are glad recipients of that love. We thank you for the love that you have shown. Now, Lord, may we live that life of love out as well, receiving you and in loving others around us in much the same way. As we give gifts, may those gifts be gifts of love, not just at Christmas, but through the rest of the year, as we're emissaries of the incredible love of God through Jesus Christ. Lord, I pray a blessing on each family in this congregation tonight, that you would bless them and fill them with your love. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. As has been our custom, we'll sing these last few songs. We'll begin to light our candles and sing these two very simple Christmas songs, and then end up singing, of course, that incredible O Holy Night, that incredible ballad of worship to our Savior. And so you can feel free to go ahead and light your candles. Yes, they're electronic, and we're thankful for the changes that were made this year and the upgrades that were made in our sanctuary, and let that light shine, amen? John, yeah, thank you. Yeah, that's beautiful. It looks so pretty tonight, doesn't it? Yeah. You know, I know maybe the church isn't full, but we could be full, really, I guess, you know, we're thankful for the light that's here, amen?
Oh,
feel the power of the words that we sing here on this incredibly holy, holy night.
Thank you.
this holy night, we pledge ourselves to you. We come like the shepherds, and we bow before you. We journey like the Magi did, and we come and we present gifts to you. We raise our voices like the angels and declare that you are God. And we look at you in humble adoration, perhaps as the mother and father, Mary and Joseph, did. And we thank you that you have come as this incredible gift into this world. We bless you and we thank you. And Lord, on this day that we honor you, we thank you that it's such a great day of celebration for us, that you share that with us, that we might be full of joy. Thank you for this. Praise you. In Jesus' wonderful, mighty, matchless name we pray. And all God's people said,
amen.
Amen. Amen. May the Lord grant you a very Merry Christmas from my heart, from my family. I speak from this Laura, from my family, from the staff, from the board here, the congregation. God bless you. Have a wonderful Merry Christmas. Thanks for sharing this night with us.